Welcome to this, the sixth habit of highly effective internet marketers in the series, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective Internet Marketers. And in this video, we're going to be looking at relationship building. And this has several different connotations. It has connotations in terms of joint ventures and the people you work with. It also has an impact on the people you use for outsourcing and will also have an effect on the people who buy from you, your customers in the first place. So let's have a look at the first element of relationship building. It's very important to choose the relationships you surround yourself with, and there's the idea which has been put out by lots of internet marketers. I'm not entirely sure where it originates from, I must admit, but the idea is that your five closest friends reflect your income. So the people that you associate them with the very most in life, the people you hang out with, are a good reflection of how much you will earn. If you take all of their incomes and you divide them by the number of people in that group, so in this case it's five, then that's a good reflection of how much you will earn every year. And what this does is it shows that the people who you surround yourself with are very important in terms of your success. If you surround yourself with people who are failing or who are poor, then there's a chance that you will also take on a lot of their mindset, a lot of their mentality, and a lot of their either success or, in this case, lack of success. So it's very important that you surround yourself by success. And if you do that, you have this thing which I call success mindset osmosis. And this success mindset osmosis is basically that if you surround yourself with successful people, then you almost start to take on a lot of their qualities, a lot of their practices, a lot of the mindset that they have. Just by hanging out with them, just by being around them, it starts to sort of filter into your unconscious and you just start to do things slightly differently. So if you can surround yourself with successful people, then you can benefit from this osmosis effect of success. It's also important to create rapport with the people around you, not just with the people in your peer group, but also with your customers. It's important that you listen to your customers, because if you listen to them, then you can provide them with exactly what they want, and as a result, deliver a much better service to them than somebody who's just guessing. If you just guess what people want, then you might have some successes, but the chances are you're going to fail most of the time, because you're going to be guessing the whole time, and it's not based on any sort of fact. And this goes back to our niche research that we talked about in the very first video, with the awareness that you have of the niche and the awareness of how those people speak and how they work, how they communicate, how they trust, you know, what is it that makes them trust a certain person within their niche, what credibility does that person need to have. All of those things are very important, and if you listen to your customers, you'll find this information out, which is very simple. If you already have a mailing list, every so often, why not ask them a question, ask them what they want, and you'll get the result of having exactly the information that they need, which in turn will give you a very good idea of what products you can market to them. It's important, as I say, to build trust with that list, to build rapport with them. So if you are giving away lots of good free information, and then suddenly you just start selling them and stop giving them free information, they'll stop trusting you, because they trusted you to give them good free information. So it's important that you make sure that you give them an idea of what you're going to be doing from the very beginning. So if you give them great free information, then, you know, sell them something on the back of that, and if they want it, and they'll stay on your list. If they trust you to do that, then they'll stay on your list. If you suddenly break that trust by not providing good enough quality products, or you provide affiliate offers that are just not up to the right standard or not relevant to them, then you'll find that a lot of people unsubscribe, because you will have broken their trust. So it's important to remain in their good books, remain trustworthy to them, and that's a very important part of creating that rapport with them. It's also a good idea to try and master persuasion as much as you can. Now, this is not to be confused with, you know, kind of blackmailing people into buying from you. You definitely don't want to do that, because, again, that kind of breaks the trust with people. What you want to be good at is learning how to persuade people that you have what they want, what they need. And there's lots of good sources for information on that. One of the best ones is a book called Influence by Robert Cialdini, who's a PhD in psychology, but specifically in persuasion. And the book is called Influence, the Psychology of Persuasion. If you get a copy of that, you will probably realize that it's one of the most significant books to be written for people within our industry of recent times. And it applies to offline business just as much as online. It gives you an idea of what the triggers are that people buy with, why it is that people buy. You'll learn things about the fact that people often buy according to desires, not according to needs. They tend to buy according to desire, and then they will justify it later on. Similarly with pricing of things, they will justify the price of paying for something afterwards rather than beforehand, because they will experience desire in the first place and only want to justify it later on. They'll only use logic when it comes to the justification. They won't necessarily use logic when it comes to buying. They'll use desire and their wants much more. So knowing about those sorts of things, knowing what persuades people, even down to the colours that people trust and that people don't trust, and what those colours represent to people, when it comes to the buy now button, for example, those are all very important important elements, and elements of persuasion that I think you need to get a handle on if you are going to be a very successful internet marketer. It's also important that your relationship building has a personal touch to it. It's important because people tend to buy people first, and I've put in brackets there like them, so people buy people like them first. People associate with people who are similar to them because it tends to reinforce who they are, it gives them a sense of identity, and if they can see a bit of themselves in somebody else, it gives them a natural rapport with that person, because they feel like they know that person, they feel like they can identify with them. That's why online video is so powerful, because it very quickly sorts out or sifts out the people who are like you and the people who don't, and as a result, the people who like you and the people who don't like you. And again, that's something that's going to happen, by the way. People will either like you or not like you, or they'll be kind of indifferent to you. You're just going to concentrate on the people who like you, because that's going to be the tribe of people that you're going to serve within your particular market or your particular niche. Different people respond to people differently and respond to marketing in different ways. So as a result, don't try and please everybody. Just try and be as personal as you can, and as personable as you can as well, so that you are unique and that you fit into that particular market and that particular group of people. It's important that you use the market's language as well, that you speak in similar terms to them. So again, this goes back a little bit to building trust with people. If they feel that you're like them, they will trust you much more, because if you're like them, they already trust themselves, obviously. So if they trust their own opinion, then they will trust the opinion of somebody who seems to be like them as well. And you can get like them, get like your market, by using the same language. So go into forums and find out what the words are. For example, in internet marketing, there's a lot of terms and a lot of ideas that people have. For example, taking action. If you take action on something, then that's considered to be a good thing in internet marketing, because lots of people don't take action. But even that phrase, just by using the phrase take action, it's different to using the phrase do the business, or using the phrase be successful, or using the phrase they could all mean similar things, but take action is sort of the industry standard, if you like. Also, there's more technical things, like the industry standard for search engines is Google, because Google has most of the searches. So you will tend to say Google something rather than search engine something or search for something. You'll say Google, because Google is the industry standard, and people recognize all of these things. It can be even more specific, with pay-per-click, for example. There's very specific terminology that goes with pay-per-click advertising. It also happens with cost per action advertising. Even that very phrase, cost per action, or CPA for short, is something that internet marketers will identify with, which they wouldn't identify with if it was phrased in a different way. So make sure that you go in and use the industry standard. There might, for example, be an industry standard in the car parts industry, if that's what your product's about. It could be about persuasion, it could be about psychology. Again, there's certain things that psychologists will recognize and will respect, because you've used their language rather than trying to make up a language of your own. As a result, you can also help to tap into the desires of the customer, and this is a very, very important part of persuasion. Again, as I mentioned earlier on, people will tend to buy based on desire rather than based on what they actually need. There'll be a desire to be like other people, or it'll be a desire to have the latest technology. So, for example, the Apple iPhone taps into both of those desires, the desire to be like other people who are kind of cool because they've got the new latest thing, and also the desire to have that latest thing. They are both being used very well by Apple and Apple's marketing department in launching the iPhone, because it seems like everyone has one nowadays, and if you don't have one, it seems like you're a little bit behind, or you don't quite have the same level of cool as the target market has. So it's important that you tap into their desires as well, because desires are much more powerful than actual needs at the end of the day. People's desire is to be financially free, or people's desire is to be beautiful, or to look good, or to have the latest application on their Apple iPhone, you know, whatever it might be. You need to tap into those desires rather than their needs. No one needs an Apple iPhone, but lots of people want it. So it's important that you look at that as well. Also, when you're building relationships, bear in mind that you're not just building a relationship, you're building an asset. And this could be in the form of lists, or in the form of knowledge, or in the form of resources. And each of those things have a value far greater than money. So for example, having a list of, you know, 5 or 10,000 people within your niche who trust you and like you is a very, very powerful thing, and much more powerful than just having a couple of £1,000 or $1,000 in your bank account. It's a much more powerful thing, because it means that you have an asset which you can leverage again and again in the future. Knowledge again is a very very big asset to build, and if you can build your assets in terms of relationships, so for example getting relationships with people who have the knowledge that you need, that's a very powerful tool as well. Similarly, if you can build relationships with people who have big lists, or people who have the resources that you need in terms of maybe outsources that they use, all of those things become very important, because it becomes about the relationship. Again, if that person who you're perhaps maybe doing a joint venture with trusts you and likes you, then that's something that's a powerful relationship that can be leveraged over and over again, and they will help you and you will help them. So that becomes a very powerful part of relationship building. Bear in mind that you are building assets as well as just relationships with people, because those people have lists, have resources, or have knowledge, or maybe all three. I mentioned joint ventures just then, and as I say, the fastest way to build a list or to build success online is to do lots of good joint ventures. Now, the joint ventures obviously have to benefit everyone. It's what I talked about in the last video about win-win-win situations. But if you network at events, even if you network offline with people, you can create a personal relationship with that person whereby they've actually met you, they've looked into your eyes, they've shaken your hand, they've talked to you about the way their business is going, and you've talked to them about yours, and you've started to build a relationship that's far deeper than just the one that exists online. Even if you use video in your marketing online, it's still not nearly as powerful as actually being there and actually shaking the hand of the person you're going to be doing business with, because again, that creates a level of trust and a level of knowledge that you are the real deal, you are what you say you are, and that's a very powerful way of building relationships with people, which again, you can leverage in the future. For example, if you were to meet somebody you could do a joint venture with who is about to bring out a new product, then you could talk to them about the best ways to promote that product. You could say to them, well, what's the best bonus I could create for your clients that would make me more sales, that would give you something extra, and that would sell more of your product, you know, and obviously give the customers as much value as possible. What could I do? What could be the bonus? So if you could create that by doing that at an event rather than just doing it online, you're going to stick in the mind of that person much more, somebody who's proactive. Even just by being at the events, you are already taking a proactive stance. So if anyone is setting out an event near you in internet marketing, for example, the World Internet Summit is a good example. If you go to that, then already you are being more proactive, and people will appreciate you for that more than somebody who just sits on their computer all day. It's important as well that you create communities when you're doing joint ventures, because that little community, even if just 4 or 5 people come on board as joint venture partners for you, you can look after them, you can make them more money, they will in turn make you more money, and it becomes almost like a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you give them some value, they will give you back some value, and it will just keep building and building until all of you have multi-million businesses, if that's what you want, you know, or they'll build businesses that help lots of people if that's your goal, or they'll build charity organizations that will help the world. Any of those things are possible if you have the right group of people around you and the right relationships. So that's an overview of relationship building, as well as some specifics on how to go about doing it, particularly with the offline events. We've got one more point to cover, and that will be the 7 habits. So have a look at video 7 of the 7 habits of highly successful internet marketers. I'll see you on the next video.